Blog Talk Radio.
Hello, everyone. This is Chrism, and I'd like to welcome you to another program about your Kundalini Awakening experience. And today, as I did last week, I would like to bring Om into the picture. So here we go. Welcome, everybody. And from the Radiant Sutras, cast aside the 10,000 things and love only one. Don't go on to another. Engage your lively awareness with this one focus, one object, one thought, one symbol. Then go inside and find the center, right here, in the middle of the feeling. Attend the blossoming. Attention vast as the sky. And another reading from the Radiant Sutras. I would like to welcome my co-host, Amelia Suntara. Hello, Amelia.
Hello, Chrism. Good to be here. And hello, listeners. Good to be here. Welcome, everybody.
Hello. Oops, wait a minute here. Just a second. My apologies. Your Holiness.
Okay.
Say something, Amelia.
Testing 1, 2, 3. You sound good, Chrism. I can hear you very clearly. Can you hear me?
Not working too well.
Okay. Well, I'll speak while Chrism is doing what he's doing. Welcome, everybody. I'm looking in the chat room, and we have a nice group gathering. I now hear an echo, Chrism. That wasn't there. Oh, it's gone again. Okay. So welcome, everybody, in the chat room. It's good to see you. Hi, Elizabeth. I'm seeing your hello. And Mike tells us that everybody sounds good, so that's excellent. And Mike, the typing in your left hand is excellent. So please, if you have any questions or comments, do use them. Oh, there goes the
hello.
The echo again. Hello, Chrism.
Yeah, were you able to hear me before?
Yes, up the point where you introduced me. And then you said, hold on a minute, but I could hear you making noises.
Oh, okay. All right. So am I being heard okay on this computer?
Yes, you're being heard very, very well.
They had me a bit worried because the on-air time clock is wrong. And so I wasn't quite sure whether I should use the iPad or this other computer. So.
Chrism, the on-air time has been wrong on the big laptop here for a number of weeks with me. So don't worry. It's Blog Talk doing its thing.
All right. Well, I'd like to say hello to everybody on the in the chat room. Two Chicken Wings and Elizabeth. Hello, Bashji. Guest 1124, 1128, 50. 159 or 15951, Mike Strong and Steve Jarecki. Hello, everyone. Today's discussion about your Kundalini Awakening experience is going to revolve around the many levels and expressions of giving all in order to receive all. Okay. And that's not as easy a practice as it might might be to say it. But first, Amelia Suntara wants to come back on. And she has a few announcements that she would like to make.
Well, I have indeed. Here I go. The first announcement I'd like to make, I'm just a bit concerned because I can hear an echo, Chrism.
Turn your, put your headphones on and then, you know, you won't be heard out loud so much.
Yeah, no, my headphones are on. As a matter of fact, it's gone again now, so I'll just speak away here. Okay, so the first thing I'd like to speak about is how you can make a donation if you would like to contribute and support the work that Chrism does on Kundalini Awakening Systems. Chrism, his teachings are in many places on the internet, which are an amazing support for people. I'm sure Chrism later will give you the various places that you can go to, including YouTube, if you want to listen to his teachings. And I'm going to give you now where you can go if you would like to make a donation. And please know that there is no pressure for anybody to donate unless they're in a position to do so and they're able to do so and they would like, through their ability to do that, to actually support the work that Chrism does. So here is the website. It is www.ascension-kundalini.blogspot.com. That's www.ascension-kundalini.blogspot.com. And on the upper right-hand side, you will see the donate button. And once you press that, it's a very simple procedure after that. So all donations are indeed most gratefully received. And if you're in a position to do so, well, then they would be very much welcomed. I don't have any other announcements except perhaps to say that if you want to ring in, please do so. The guest number is the USA, then 347-934-0026, and I would be delighted to receive your call. And if you would like to speak with Chrism on air, I will pass you through. Or if you would prefer not to do that or give an anonymous name, that's perfectly okay as well. If you're in the chat room, you can also type a message. And Chrism is seeing the chat room today, so that's wonderful. He'll actually see your message. I will not have to relay it to him. And I'm sure that Eileen or Rosemary will be able to make an announcement about the seminar that's happening in September. So that's me for now, Chrism.
Thank you. Thank you.
Listening.
Okay. If any of you good folks in the chat room would let me know if the sound goes bad, as it has sometimes, blog talk. So let me know if you would, please. Give us a note. So the idea of giving all in order to receive all, there are aspects of that ideology that work very, very well with the Kundalini. Although the first thing that a person wants to understand is that you're not giving anything to receive grace. In other words, you're not going to be able to barter or buy your enlightenment. In many ways, it's already been decided, you know, before you even took the body. Okay, so, but what you can do is you can give away or remove the blockage of the ego expectation out of the road of your Kundalini expansion. And by giving all, I'm going to suggest that you give complete control of your life to the Kundalini, even if there are other lives that are dependent upon yours, such as children or people at work, you know, friends and family, these types of things. Kundalini doesn't necessarily want to take you away from your emotional responsibilities and you know, physical responsibilities. Not at all. But it may ask you to do as the Radiance Sutra asked you to do, and I'll read it once again here. Cast aside the 10,000 things and love only one. Don't go on to another. Engage your lively awareness with this one focus, one object, one thought, one symbol. Then go inside, find the center, right here, in the middle of the feeling. Attend the blossoming, attention vast as the sky. You reach a certain stage in your spiritual evolution and you come to the Kundalini. And once you come to the Kundalini, you're stepping into an area that once you're there, there is no turning back. There is no rewind button that says, oh, okay, you can forget that now, or you can fix this, or you can manipulate it. You don't get to manipulate Kundalini so much as it manipulates you. So if Kundalini has come to you, but let's just say that it's not comfortable or it's not in any way working out for you, there's way too much fear, there's way too much anxiety, there's way too much this or that, well then this is where the giving of yourself can really, really make a difference. You begin to live a new life that is being sculpted for you by the Kundalini. Not by entities, discarnate entities, which are completely different. There's a completely different feel with a discarnate entity. And since I brought that up, I better go into that a little bit. A discarnate entity often will have some sort of a self-serving agenda, a self-serving agenda or a selfish agenda, an agenda that is asking you to inflict pain or cheat or, you know, do something that would go against any of the noble behaviors. That is typically what an entity will say, I am God, in order to trick you into doing what it wants you to do. Okay, the Kundalini will never do that. The radiance that comes from the Kundalini incarnate, so i.e. the Kundalini that's awakening within you, the divine connection and the radiance that comes with that divine connection will tell you enough. Okay, you'll be able to discern from there. But sometimes, you know, the entities get pretty tricky. So always, always, always be aware of your ethics and your values and your morality and the whole bit. Okay? It's very important. And so... Usually when the Kundalini comes, because we're forced to change a little bit, we grudgingly give in to that force and say we stop eating meat or we eat more vegetables or, you know, whatever the case may be for the individual. And so in a way, once again, you're giving of yourself into that situation, even though you're kind of being forced into it. You're still receiving, and you will still continue to receive. But what I'm suggesting is now, instead of blocking it or resisting it or having it forced upon you by the energy itself, actively engage the energy of Kundalini. Actively accept and surrender to the consciousness that is the Kundalini. Seriously, do this. And let this build within you the ability and the desire to give all. Giving everything that you are. Now you may be sitting there going, well, how the heck do you do that? How do you give everything you are? I mean, what am I going to give him? My finger? Which some of you may be doing anyway. By this I mean you give control of your life. You give, I'm just reading the chat room here. Thanks, Mike and Amelia. Thank you both. So as you begin to not resist this, you begin to open up channels within yourself that is equivalent to giving the all that you are. This is giving your attention, giving your love, giving your grace, giving the control of your life, the control of your thoughts and emotions and feelings, giving Kundalini total saturation upon your being as your being is expressed in this physical reality. Total Kundalini saturation. You got to understand that the Kundalini knows you. It knows what job you have. It knows how many kids you have. It knows all of your responsibilities. It knows these things about you. Okay. I think that you can afford to step out of the way of yourself a little bit and listen to that Kundalini voice within you. Feel it. Feel the voice. Even as you hear these words, that voice is signaling to you and talking to you, a tingling at the base of the spine, maybe some pressure at the base of the spine, some heat, maybe some pressure at your third eye, maybe pressure or some phenomena in the palms of your hands, in the palms of your feet. Even as I speak to you in this way, how do I get that one thing? I'll do this. That'll do it. Okay. So even as I speak these words, the Kundalini is coming into you and beginning to manifest change upon you. We're right in the middle of a Shaktipat cycle right now. The scatter fields have been placed and we're waiting for the 21st of June, 2014. Right now is a really, really good time to visit your level of surrender to the Kundalini. In what way will you try to control the Kundalini? In what way will you block the natural divine information that's coming into you? What levels of comfort are you willing to let go of? And what levels of comfort must you insist upon? And where is the balance between those two polarities for you? Are you able to give your all? Not everybody will be. You got kids? Well, you can't. Okay? You can give as much as the Kundalini wants you to give, though, even if you have children. I mean, having children is not a stigma. It's a blessing. So the Kundalini understands that you have children, and so your equation is adjusted for that. Let's just call it a self-adjusting equation. So yeah, in order to give, and really give, you have to let go of the barriers that your ego puts up to block the way a certain phenomena or the way a certain issue is to be dealt with. As I mentioned, we're right in the middle of a Shaktipat period, and I want to put it out to those of you in the chat room and those of you listening in the archives in the future. I have people that take Shaktipat from me over and over and over, and it works. You know, they get the Shaktipat, but the interesting thing is, you know, once the phenomena comes along, they try to dampen the phenomena. I light a fire at the base of their spine, and they're busy trying to step on the fire. I want you to think about that. What part of you needs to be in control of this equation, this Kundalini equation? What part of you demands to have that control and demands to be able to step on a holy gift or allow a holy gift to flourish? Look at that and see where it is inside yourself that type of a consciousness might reside. This will block you. Most people are blocked by their comfort levels. Okay, so if the Kundalini, which it will do, it will typically go outside of a person's comfort levels. You know, just by virtue of what it is, it will go outside of comfort levels, and there you are. You know, you have this choice. You can take a medication, and maybe the symptom will go away, or you can go to a Swami or a Guru and maybe they can alleviate that energetic signature upon you. Or you can just accept the gift and let that acceptance begin to help you change into the phenomena that's occurring. And of course, you know, we always need to keep aware of the ethical and moral guidelines with this. We don't want to just, you know, think that we're just going to jump in and that we can forget about all that. No. Because, you know, as I mentioned earlier, you know, discarnate entities, spirits, call them what you will, the parasitical consciousness may try to come up to you, may try to persuade you to do this or to do that. And this is when you really need to hold on to your ethics very, very strongly, because most of these entities have no ethics, or they have an ethics system that is not compatible with a human behind the veil flesh human ethics table. Theirs is very different. Far more predatory. Far more predatory. Okay. And so this will happen to a person within the Kundalini Awakening experience. You know, they'll have, you know, perhaps an entity experience. And once again, the ethics will help steer you through that experience. As will I. I mean, if anybody here wants to contact me about that, my email is kfireforall@yahoo.com. That's kfireforall@yahoo.com. You can get a hold of me, and I can also help you with that. Another way to really open the gates of your Kundalini equation into and of yourself is through the devotion. Become very devotional with the Kundalini. Become devotional with what the Kundalini sends to you to become devotional with. Lots of you are receiving information from the Kundalini all the time. You just don't know all the time what the source is, and you don't necessarily take a look at what the source is. So, you know, the Kundalini is giving you a source, and you're just kind of responding, because that's how we're used to doing it. We kind of instinctually respond to any given situation, and with that instinct, we sculpt our life with. And a lot of it is in response to another action that's been taken towards us. Oh, I see. Okay, so Sarah has a lot of questions. You want to put her through, Amelia?
Hi.
Hey.
Hi.
How are you?
Hi. I'm doing okay. Except that I can hear myself.
Why don't you turn your computer down?
It's not my computer.
Not my
I'm
computer.
On my phone.
I'm on my phone.
Ah, well.
That's weird.
You have a headset?
Yes, I'm wearing it. Should I try to take it out?
Yeah, maybe try that. See
okay,
if
let's
that
try
helps.
That. Hang on. Let me see if I can hear myself. Can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay.
I can still hear myself.
No,
I hate that.
Your laptop is gone, Tara. It was there, but now it's gone.
Okay, it's gone now?
Yeah.
Thank you, hon. I can still hear myself. Are you there, Chrism?
What a team. That's all I can say. What a team.
Right? Oh, okay. I guess one of my questions would be, when information comes in, how do you know that it's coming from the correct place? You know,
well, that's what I was talking about. That's when you deal with. You have to become, you know, very close to your ethics, to your moral code, and if it starts, and typically, if it's going to go in a shall we say a challenging way, a challenging direction, often the way of the challenge will go against your ethical structure. Because we wear a lot of our thoughts and issues and emotions on a level of our aura that can be seen by others. In a way, because we're behind the veil, we're open books for certain consciousness to come along and look at and go, oh, okay, there's a special fear, or, oh, there's a special concern, and da-da-da-da-da. You know, and so if they're able to break through that aspect of the veil, like certainly during dreams or something like that, well, they'll try to come through, and they'll try to make you go against whatever cherry-picked item they've found in your aura.
Can
dreams be implanted? And the reason I'm asking you this is because I had a particular dream that was very important, and the soulmate person, my soul flame, my twin flame, okay? And so I got into reading about this whole Christ Michael business. And I don't know if you're familiar or not, and the Phoenix and the
is
what?
This is the channeler, right?
He claims to have been in the body with Jesus the Christ. So
that's the first thing you can go. Okay, you notice that he's giving himself an exalted position.
Correct. Correct.
So you begin to look at, oh, okay, what aspects of self-aggrandizement are being projected here? What is it he's trying to say to people on a subliminal level?
Okay, yes, with you. With you, but don't judge him on that. Because he is very, okay. He claims that he left the body when Jesus ascended and went back to his universe and has been gone for a very, very long time. Okay, but he is going to return in this Phoenix spaceship. And it also discusses the Agarthans and Sanat Kumara. How are you feeling about the Agarthans and all of that? And do you think this is all BS and Satan stuff? Because I really don't want to open a portal to hell. Do you understand?
Yeah. Kundalini is not of Satan.
Oh, I know that.
Yeah. Okay. And so as far as this person goes, what I'm getting about them is this is not a person to follow.
Okay. And there's a whole network of the I really don't want to offend anyone because they have great information. He is affiliated with the I Am presence. And which they would like you to invoke fully. And do you understand where I'm going with this?
I do. And you know, just so you understand where I'm going with this is the I Am presence is in within all of us. You don't need to join an organization or follow somebody who says that they've been doing some fairly strong, fantastic, phenomenological types of scenarios. He doesn't go out and say, "Oh yeah, I was a ditch digger back in the time of Christ." It's not that. It's no. I am right up there with Jesus.
I had already gotten that information, but you know, it's like I have something and I know it, so I wrote it down so that I would remember, and big red letters. This is bull crap. I wrote that on my notebook after hours and hours of writing things down, and I decided this is bull crap. Someone was trying to trick me. Yes. I had the dream, but that doesn't mean anything.
Well, no, dreams do mean things. Dreams definitely. Within a Kundalini context, I have to ask you what. What kind of experience do you have with the Kundalini?
When you say Kundalini, if you are referring to when I ask myself questions or have a question in my mind that it gets answered, is that what?
No.
Or
that can be,
because I
that can be anything.
Okay, you see what? Listen here, Chrism. I know you're laughing, but I have had a real problem. meditating. And
well, here's the thing. You know what you're telling me is that when you have a question and it gets answered, it depends on how the question is answered. How is it answered? Do you get a voice?
A thought. Sometimes a thought. It's just a thought that comes to mind immediately. And I think that it's a lot easier for negative entities to throw a thought in there than if I'm meditating in a meditative state. I have heard, I don't know if this is true, but I have heard in a meditative state, unless you have somehow protected yourself, you might just go somewhere, you know, you don't want to go.
Well, this is true. This is true. I think that, you know, there's a whole level of experience that a person can have that would be challenging and difficult and uncomfortable to be in. You know, look at where anybody that's addicted to alcohol or methamphetamine or any of those folks, you know, that reality that they're dealing with is accessible by you, even though you're not doing the drug.
Mm-hmm.
So, there are areas, of course, that a person can go to that are far less comfortable than the current one that they're at. However, within the context of the Kundalini, if you stick to strong, noble behaviors, love, forgiveness, compassion, helpfulness, truth, honesty, those types of behaviors, it's though the quality of that practice is it seasons the shall we say, I'm trying to put it in earthy terms, it seasons the frequencies that make up your aura, and it basically kind of acts as a deterrent.
Gotcha. Right. I understand.
Yeah.
They already know not to mess with me because every action I make is based upon love, compassion, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm vibrating on a different frequency, and that's why I don't negative.
Expand it beyond mere humanity, and expand it into the bacteria, into the viruses, into the, you know, into all God's creation,
mm-hmm.
not just a human one. We share this planet, and we share the planet by the benevolence of other races and creatures here on this world.
Yes,
you know, if
yes.
the ants were all of a sudden to act up on this planet, we'd be gone in less than 3 days.
I agree with you. I totally agree, and I completely understand. Now the flies are starting to get to me. I'll be honest with you, the flies are they're getting to me. But other than that, I love everything.
Are you down? Where are you at? What country are you in?
Arkansas.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, you got that hot, humid environment there.
Yes, I do. And it's terrible.
So if you're receiving a thought as an answer to a question, depending on the quality of the thought, so if the thought is go and steal that person's purse, well, that's a low quality thought to have sent to you. But if the quality is, you know, help that woman cross the street, well, then you have a very different quality, and that's the quality that you want to follow. And so you have to kind of keep a track record of the different thoughts and the different suggestions, the different informations that are coming through, so that you can make sure that you are always on a high moral ethic landing, okay?
And that's a given. That's a given. So as long as I am living for everyone, for the betterment of the whole the world, the highest good, everything I do, I always make sure, you know, is this in the highest good of this other person, et cetera, then I don't need to question anything. But what I'm telling you that I keep questioning, and I think I'm going to answer my own problem question here, is that I want to put people in, let's not say people, anything, a thought, I want to put them in boxes or label them, and I have to realize I'm hoping this is correct, that each person, a person can't be good or evil. They're all put here to teach us something. And, well, yes, there are definitely evil people in the world, a lot of them. But because I want to label a person good or evil. And my intuition sometimes tells me, whoa, step back. This person might be tricking you. Are you see where I'm going with that? That's what I question, is my own thoughts.
Well, you look at other people and you have to realize that they were all children at one time. And, you know, basically adults are the equivalent, most adults, I'd say the majority of adults are just, you know, the emotional equivalent of a 12-year-old child or an 11-year-old child sometimes. You know, we don't teach emotional maturation in our society. It's somehow inflicted on us, but we don't sit down and go, okay, hey, you know, here's some appropriate behaviors and here's some not. And because of that, you know, it's easy for us to have our moral compass challenged through the emotional body. And, you know, what I'm suggesting is that you buttress or you support the emotional body's awareness of truth by practicing those behaviors that are based in truth. And that would be the noble behaviors. And what happens then is you're able to discern what is truth and what isn't.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I understand. Okay. I just get a lot of experience. Do you know what I mean?
Sure.
And people trying to trip me up, and apparently some pretty damn powerful folks who are able to block thoughts and do some other stuff, and people in my own family, you know, which is pretty.
So you just forgive them. You just forgive them. Mm-hmm. The more you forgive them, the less hold they have on you. You forgive them, you let it go, and it no longer bothers you.
Right.
Okay.
I understand that.
And then since you know what the level of truth is coming from the mouths of certain people, whatever, then you know in the future that, oh, okay, this is so-and-so talking, and so I know that, you know, they're a little truth challenged in some of these areas. So we'll just be very careful what we choose to believe when it comes to that.
Gotcha. I understand that.
You never have to fall victim to the same person twice.
Right.
Not that you're a victim, but you know what I mean. The same game doesn't have to be played on you twice.
Yes. With me it has, but I know better now. And I was really concerned, though, I think more than anything, that I'm receiving information from so many different places, if you will.
Here's one thing that you can do. If you go to the website, KundaliniAwakeningSystems1.com, go to that website, you go to the area that is, I think it's called More Support or Support, and you'll come down to a picture of Chrism, and that is a healing photo.
Okay.
And just stare into the eyes. You'll notice one eye is going off into nowhere. The other eye is looking right at you. That's a picture that has a lot of Kundalini Shakti in it.
Okay.
And what you do is you just stare into the eyes of the picture, and you say something easy, some sort of an easy mantra, is like, I'm in love with love, or I'm in love with truth. I am truth. I am love. Something of that nature. And you allow yourself to be assisted by the energy in that photo. And that will pretty much begin to block away many of the discarnate interference that a person may have.
Okay. Because earlier you were speaking about having tingling in your third eye or in your palm or maybe something in my head. Well, you know what's crazy is that... I don't have that anymore. I had it strongly, very quickly after I had archontic implants removed and a healing, if you will, and supposedly protection out to infinity. And I did have a lot of tingling, and I had some pretty major experiences, but I don't have a tingle anymore.
Did you say archontic implants?
Yeah. Yes.
I see.
Yes, that were like in my etheric. In my etheric field, supposedly put there by the bad archons, the bad aliens. Are you with me? Was this? Should I have not done this?
Who told you that you had the implants?
I know where you're going with this, and I already had that intuition as well. That's a website. I've read a lot about it. Do you believe in the dark forces who came to the earth?
Yeah, the dark force has always been with the earth. It's the darker forces of the human expression that is far more predominant here than that of an alien nation.
Sure.
Now, you really want to? I mean, I'm going to suggest that you take this archon and this ideology, this fear-based information, and you don't let it bother you anymore.
Okay.
Really has nothing to do with your evolution except how you evolve through different states and phases of fear and anxiety.
Okay.
You're not going to change the status of the United States and the Earth within the many different civilizations of the Milky Way. You know, whether the archons are here, whether we call them archons, for crying out loud, they could just be idiots.
Right, right.
Come on, you know. And so you just want to get that kind of detritus out of your path. You live a virtuous and holy life, and you can expect to be challenged. Okay, you can expect it. Hello. Am I going to get some sort of a phone call? Hello. Hi, it's me again. Sorry. Did I interrupt you?
Me? No, you did. You talking to me?
Well, I am talking to you, yes. Yes.
No, you did not interrupt me. You did not interrupt me. But when
did
you were speaking...
Did your phone...
No.
Okay.
No, but listen, you never know what's going to happen around here with me, my phone, the energy, all this weirdness. It's happening in my life, it's weird.
you don't need to buy into every... It's like these Radiant Sutras said... You know, cast aside the 10,000 things, Sarah, and love only one. Don't go on to another. Engage your lively awareness with this one focus, one object, one thought, one symbol. Then go inside and find the center. Now, for you, Sarah, I'm going to suggest that this is Kundalini for you. Otherwise, why would you even be listening to this program? So forget about the aliens. Forget about the Archons, although I have to say one of my favorite Star Treks is The Last of the Archons, I think, something like that. So.
Yeah, and I feel like, I mean, what I've been told is that's the way we're going to be, is living like Star Trek, and we'll all get along, and everything will be wonderful. The Klingon, you know, everyone, that's, do I believe that? I'm not sure, but the fact that I have seen two Klingons leave some credence to that. Lend some credence to it.
Well, that's great. And so, you know, even within, you know, that type of phenomena, be holy, be of a character of nobility, of noble behaviors, and buy into that. Only buy into that. You can accept whatever you see on the side of the river on either bank, but keep your canoe in the middle of the stream.
I understand, but when you keep saying nobility, you keep saying nobility, and that bothers me because I don't. I mean, yes, I have been nobility in the past, no doubt. But I do not want to look upon my fellow man.
Do you know what the word noble means? Do you know what the word noble means?
Maybe not.
Yeah, it's practicing the qualities of forgiveness, love, tolerance, honesty, patience, gratitude, tolerance, service. Those are the noble qualities. Those are qualities of nobility.
Hmm.
It's not the Duchess of Earl.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
You see where. Yeah.
Not Queen Elizabeth. It's about qualities that express some of the higher aspects of human interaction.
Okay. That leads me. Thank you. And sorry for interrupting so much, but that is helping me tremendously because I know that somewhere along the line, surely I'm not the only person who, links that word nobility with people like the people you were just speaking of, and I am nothing like those people. So do you, and also.
You're far more similar to them than you are different. Yes.
Well, I see your point.
They have skin. You have skin. They have blood. You have blood. They have hair, eyes, nose, mouth, teeth,
mm-hmm.
neck. So do you.
I get that. What was I going to ask?
That's beside the point. It is.
It's what I do with this life right now that I'm living. Okay,
right.
I realize I have connections to all that. I gotcha. I get it. But I will refuse to ever use any gift or something that I may have in my possession, and if that's big and wanted by all, I will refuse to use that for negative things. I will always use it for the highest good and be a healer and help others and assist and et cetera. The hierarchy. Yes.
Well,
do you?
Who is the hierarchy?
The hierarchy.
Hierarchy.
Yeah. Do you? I don't believe in.
You pronounce it hierarchy as well, right?
Correct. And so if there's a school of thought out there that says the Great White Brotherhood, first of all, and they have a hierarchy in their a perfect love system outside of our universe somewhere. Why, if they're so, if we're all one, then how in the hell can there be a hierarchy? And why is there a need for a hierarchy? Do you understand where I'm going with that? And does that not go against everything I believe? Yes, it does. And who's going to call themselves the Great White Brotherhood anyway, except somebody that's white? Or do you see where I'm going with that also? I mean, I don't – so that does not resonate with me. And
I'm going to try to steer us back to the Kundalini here.
Yes, I'm sorry.
No, it's quite all right. The Kundalini will unleash it's funny. As this topic came up on some of the communities this past week is the pursuit of the occult with the Kundalini and how the Kundalini will actually enliven the consciousness to the degree that it will actively seek out anything of the occult that it can find in order to begin to discern the pathway beyond the five senses. And you certainly have been visiting the different areas or options, right, Sarah?
Of course.
So I would just, I would make a big shift for you, my dear. I would say just go for the Kundalini only. Forget about archons, forget about anarchies or hierarchies, forget about all of the drama. Mm-hmm. Forget about the fear-mongering. Forget about the excitement, the titillation. Forget about your implants. Go for the grace that is within you. Go for the divine within. If you truly want to be that person that is able to give healing, that is able to assist, that is able to do goodness upon this world, then just go for the Kundalini and let the Kundalini go for you.
Okay.
There is no other. I mean, even the alien races understand how special we are with regards to our connection to divinity.
Mm-hmm.
Something
mm-hmm.
they don't have. Something they can't have because they're afraid to take a human body.
Understand.
Okay? Go for the Kundalini alone, Sarah. That will have a huge impact on you if you can do it.
Okay. Well, I'm going to make every effort.
Well, go to the safeties on that website I gave you. Kundalini Awakening Systems 1.com. Go to the safeties protocols.
Kundalini
do the safeties protocols
awake.
Twice, once in the morning and once in the evening.
Mm-hmm.
Start out with about 6 repetitions of each Tibetan when you're doing the Tibetans.
Okay. And it was Kundalini Awakening
Systems. Right.
The
number 1.com.
Oh,
Kundalini Awakening Systems 1.com. KAS1.
Sarah, if you actually go to the homepage for this show, which you
mm-hmm.
should be able to find, there are the websites are there. The website that Chrism is telling
okay.
you about, the address is there, so you should be able to find that, and also the address of the Facebook group.
Perfect. Thank you so much. And Chrism, thank you so much for speaking with me today. You've helped me open up something that's able to allow me to answer my own questions.
Well, you just have a beautiful, beautiful day and a beautiful life, my dear.
Thank you so much. And I wish the same for you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Lots of luck. Goodbye.
Okay. All right. Well, I'd like to say thank you to Sarah for calling in with those very interesting questions. The fact of UFO phenomena on this world is somewhat of a foregone conclusion in my experience with it. The fact that they're interested in us and they want to, you know, try to figure out what we can do and why, you know, they'll still have to go into the divine aspect. And that's not something that, that's not something that they can do. And so it's the human body that is set up to reach into infinity that way, even though the physical lifespan is so short. Holy. What time is it? Yeah, 3:54. Okay. So, even though the human lifetime is so short, it has the remarkable capacity for that short time to stretch into the infinite, to stretch into the divine, and the Kundalini is part of that energetic anatomy that allows that to occur. When you give all, give up a lot of your assumptions about what you read on a website or what you heard from a group or what this teacher said or what that teacher says. It may not work for you. It is not a one-size-fits-all with the Kundalini. The Kundalini will fit all, but your individual equation with the Kundalini is going to be very, very different. Very different from the next person. Okay. So you need to really begin to give up your assumptions of knowledge, your assumptions of truth, your assumptions of what is, and replace it with an ideology or a thought process that your Kundalini supports. You have to remember that while you're in the human body and you're going through a Kundalini transformation, the transformation itself is a real thing. And so that means transformation is an indication of change, and change is an indication of movement from the status quo. So you're going to have to flow with those changes. And at first those changes will, you know, as they come strong sometimes, and you really have to just hold your breath and give in to them. Give in to those changes. Allow those changes to occur. And give yourself into those changes. You'll reach a point in your Kundalini where you'll be willing to give without the expectation of receiving. And through that lack of expectation of receiving is when you actually receive. When you take out your expectation is when the real reception can be given. Because the expectation tries to sculpt the information or the experience in a certain way that probably corresponds closer with the ego than with anything else. And so what you want to do is you want to really, really sculpt the givingness that you have to the degree that you can be completely open to what the Kundalini is having you study at any given time. From what teacher the Kundalini has you listening to at any given time. You have to remember that the Kundalini knows you have the internet. Kundalini knows this. Kundalini's in your fingertips, in your little mouse fingertip there, or touchpad fingertip, guiding your finger on where to go for this information, where to go for the next information. You know, do you listen to you know, Muji? Do you listen to Ganjaji? Do you listen to Chrism? Do you listen to, who do you listen to and why? And then you can really begin to narrow it down. Just as the sutras say, you can cast aside the 10,000 things. Well, cast aside all that different information that's coming to you. Cast aside what the many different belief systems will tell you. Cast aside what the many different teachers will tell you, the many different phases of self-aggrandizement. Cast aside and let stick what the Kundalini wants you to hear, what the Kundalini wants you to practice. And you'll know that through the feeling, the sensation that you get when you come across that information. Well, that's the information you stick with. And that's where you give your all. Give your all into that equation, into that information, into that teacher, into that system. Give your all into it. To a degree, you don't really, you know, the Kundalini will come to you regardless. But when she comes to you and you're able to hold her outstretched hand, well, that's a bond, that's an agreement. And that allows things to flow so much better, so much easier for the individual. It's extremely important to understand that. You can come kicking and screaming. And it doesn't mean that you won't get out of it without being damaged. You know, you probably will be damaged. Or you can come into this with grace and appreciation and gratitude and surrender to the agenda that's being given. Give your all that you may receive all, but give your all just because you want to give your all into truth. And in giving that allness that you are, You receive the information, or you receive the activity that the Kundalini is planning on giving you. And as you are, you know, being transformed, well, you can expect that phenomena to try to make its way to the, shall we say, the top of your attention. So, you know, as in the Shaktipat, when the phenomena comes by virtue of the Shaktipat, you know, if it comes for you, don't try to put the fire out. Don't try to get rid of the phenomena. You're going to get cold. You're going to get hot. Your feet are going to burn sometimes. Your feet are going to be really cold at other times. That doesn't mean that you immediately go and find comfort. I would rather that you go into deep appreciation and deep gratitude for the gift that is being given to you. You don't immediately go and try to cover up the gift. You give in to the strange sensation. You form your tolerance. You form your surrender. And you allow the phenomena to change you. And examine your thoughts around the phenomena. Examine your thoughts. Examine how you are. And see how that has something to teach you as well. In many cases, the Kundalini will ask you to come half the way. So for those of you who are seeking this, those of you who are nurturing it in this lifetime, come half that way, at least half that way, if not the whole way. You come and you give your essence into this equation. You give the essence and you give the attention of that essence. And you give the appropriate amount of energy and importance to what it is you're doing in that equation. This is fairly strong stuff, folks, so really, really know this, really understand this. Kundalini will do you. And I want you to let it. Trust it. But also be discerning of the gifts that it brings your way. As I was talking with Sarah, you know, stick to your high moral behaviors. Those are the things that will save you. If you've already got an entity infestation, oh, here's Mike's writing something. Well, then, Mike, the only reason that the Shakti Pot has been that successful for you, and this is Mike on the chat room, for those of you listening in the archives, Mike says, I have found the Shakti Pot has made the long-standing aches and bubbles of discomfort dissolve away, but that's just me. And it's his openness to receiving the Shakti Pot that also aids his reception. By giving into the equation and really, you know, honoring it, you will receive. You may not receive just like Mike, that you'll receive, just like you're supposed to receive. If you have a question about this or any other aspect of your Kundalini Awakening experience, call United States area code 347-934-0026. And I am going to bring Her Holiness on board here. I think. Working at it here. There we are. Hi, Rosemary.
Hi.
Hi.
How are you? You're on the air.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I believe you might have some announcements.
Yes.
Yes.
No, I have an
echo. I have an echo.
It'll go away.
Okay.
Okay.
Yes, the announcement,
is
together with
together
other Kundalini folk,
September
27th and 28th. Here in Minnesota, and Eileen and I have been working, and I've been thinking of what you said just a bit ago about things happen and sometimes they don't, and to go with that flow and just be attentive. And there are some days and I'm sure for Eileen too, the things that I set about to do for the day and connect with people, sometimes they just don't happen. And then I get a little discouraged and think I'm on the wrong track or like that. And then the next day, without much, even as much effort as the day before, the phone rings, the email comes, and people calling and asking and wanting to set up a film screening and people being willing to help. It's just very touching, all of this. And I speak for both of us in that regard, but Eileen can speak for herself, too, about the value, the treasure, the gift it is to be doing this work for the community. And it'll be a wonderful experience. It is already for us.
Thank you, Rosemary. Thank you very much. And thank you and thank Eileen for all the hard work you've done to bring this information to the people of Minnesota. What a blessing. What a blessing the two of you are. Thank you. And thank
and
you for
I can be reached at rosemaryg@usinternet.com.
Right. So everybody, that's Rosemary. That's rosemaryg@usinternet.com. And Rosemary is... with Eileen, orchestrating a seminar, a Kundalini Awakening seminar, in the Minnesota area of Minneapolis and the Twin Cities, right?
Yes, Egan. St. Paul's Egan. Side of the river.
St. Paul's side of the river. Okay, thank you, my dear. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Joining over here to Eileen. Hi, Eileen.
Hi, Chris. Hi, Chris.
Do you have anything you'd like to add?
Well, I do agree with Rosemary that there are days when things don't look so well and things aren't going well, and then we get wonderful surprises and things kind of work out. So it's an up and down, but overall I think it's really going to be a wonderful seminar. Rosemary's doing a wonderful job setting up screenings and talking to people. She has a lot of contacts, and I'm really happy I can help her out.
Well, thank you, Eileen, and thank you for that help. Thank you for being the ambassador that you are.
Oh, thank you, Chris.
All right. We have to wait a little bit for Amelia to come on. Hey, there you are. There you are. There you are.
Just to say that, you know, it's not just for people in St. Paul's in Minnesota, because it's a great location, Chrism. It's very easy to access there from Canada or from the west or the east or the south. So people that are living outside of that immediate area, the seminar is open to them too. So if you're in a position to travel either by plane or by car, or some people might even be in a position to car share or something, if you contact Rosemary, she'll know where people are coming from. So it's really exciting that it's happening in that part of the USA. So well done, Eileen and Rosemary. Very good. Excellent. Yeah.
Well, thank you, Amelia. Thank you for your rundown of that. And you're absolutely correct. It's not just for people in Canada or the United States. It is a fairly central location for the North American continent. But, you know, you can come in from Europe. You can come in from South America. You can come in from Africa. It's not a problem. And evidently, the hotel is very accommodating, and there are rooms. And so, I welcome everybody to come in. Now, Amelia, how have you given your all towards this without expecting any kind of return?
Oh, wow. It wouldn't have started, I suppose, Chrism, with me giving my all. It was a gradual process. And, I mean, at the beginning you read out that sutra, the Radiant Sutra, about being engaged in, was it 10,000 things and how...
Yeah,
let go
of 10,000 things. That's right.
Yes, yes. And really, it was Kundalini. I was blessed, I feel. Kundalini engaged my lively awareness. I think that was the word that you used as well. You know, it really engaged with me by using my body. So one of the very first things that would have happened for me was I would have started to experience physical things within my body, and that was how I began to give, because there was discomfort. Was I able to do what the Kundalini, was I able to surrender my discomfort, you know, all that sort of thing. And little by little, I was able to give more and more of myself, and even become devotional with the discomfort and with the surrender. And that made a huge difference to me. You know, I mean, there was lots of discomforts. I mean, even something like speaking about Kundalini in public, you were saying, you know, where are your comfort levels? That was a huge discomfort for me, but Kundalini demanded that I do that as I began to organize a seminar way back in 2011. And those were all opportunities or reasons for me to surrender. And so little by little, I began to give of myself in that way, and I began to expand my surrender more and more. And so, yeah, what else? I suppose it's not a linear thing, you see, Chrism, because there's a lot of things. Like, I suppose it was about the ultimate thing was about letting go of my own control and allowing the Kundalini to control and surrendering myself. I mean, you mentioned earlier about children, and that if you have children, that you can only give as much as the Kundalini wants you to give. And one of the things I found about having children was that it actually helped me in terms of surrendering, because, you know, having children, like as a mother, I had already surrendered. I had already surrendered my body to the pregnancy, to the labor, to the birth, to the demands of the baby. And so my own previous experiences of surrender, I was able to use in a way, because the Kundalini was teaching me to completely surrender my body to the control of the Kundalini and to not resist what was being given into my body. And the same with all the other aspects of my life, my comfort levels and all of that. And then through what I read on your website, through your direct teaching with me, through devotion, all of those things, and little by little, letting go of my own expectations, dropping those 10,000 things, surrendering my own beliefs, surrendering all of my, you know, assumptions, all of those things, and really focusing. I mean, you know, you were saying, I think, about having a focus. Well, that one thing, in a way, the phases were that one thing, so that no matter what else was happening, living with the high ethical value, living the ethics and sort of being willing to live a holy life. I mean, it sounds easy, but, you know, there would even be a self-resistance to that in a way, you know?
Can you pick up the new caller, my dear? I totally understand what you're saying.
Okay.
Yep. Go pick up that new caller. So, yeah, so absolutely, absolutely. And, you know, you come to these understandings, you come into this level of grace, and pretty soon you find your options being sculpted by the Kundalini for you. And this can come as a shock to you, and your ego will want to resist it. And as Suntara, you know, so excellently explained right now, there's really no reason to resist it at all. It's, I mean, it has your best interests at heart. It really does. And even though at first it may not feel that way with the ego, it is nonetheless a shall we say, a trail of truth within this whole experience. And this is an ever-evolving experience. There's no end point with Kundalini awakening while you still have a body. There is no finish line. There is no, you know, there's no field goal, there's no touchdown, there's no home run. In a way, you are all those things, but they're constantly happening. They're constantly, permanently happening over and over and over for you. In these ways, you know, are we able to be motivated, to feel motivated, and to really begin to push our way beyond the self-made barriers that we place between ourselves and our Kundalini Awakening experience? I did mention devotion before, but I do want to come to it once again. Devotion is one of the most powerful tools that a person can use with regards to the acceptance of the Kundalini as it is given, and to the maturation of a person that is coming into a Kundalini Awakening experience. When you can give love to this experience, to the Kundalini, to the teacher the Kundalini sends you, to those points on the compass within your Kundalini Awakening context, you really begin to embrace great levels of joy and love in your life, great levels of security and comfort and knowledge, and the expansion of those qualities into the new self that the Kundalini is bringing. Yes, Amelia.
Hi, Susan. We have Mike on the phone there, and he has some questions or comments. So I've passed them through to you. Hi, Mike.
Hey, Mike. Hello, Mike.
Hello. Yeah, Mike, it was funny. Right when I started interacting on the chat room, my computer crashed, so I called in to listen. But you have been talking, I have been thinking for a couple of weeks now about, people are talking about entities, and I haven't really had a lot of experience with entities, although I have had a little.
Yeah.
I, on the other hand, have had some very brief encounters with what I call fully realized masters, and I'm talking about human beings.
Okay.
The first time it was within like 6 months of my big spinal sweep, and I was cooking in a very hip restaurant in a poolside party where everybody was just cheek to jowl. There's thousands of people, and I was cooking steaks over a grill with just nonstop, as fast as I could cook the steaks, people were eating them and grabbing them straight off of my grill. And off to the side of the party, I saw the owner of the club point to me, and then three very elegant Hindu ladies dressed in saris walked up to my grill. They bowed to me, and they said, "Keep up the good work." And I said, "Okay," and then they walked away.
Did you talk to the owner to see if he put them up to it?
I did not. But I just thought. But then about a year later, I was driving cab now, and a guy hailed my cab, and I picked him up, and he was obviously Samoan or Hawaiian, a big guy, probably 400 pounds, jolly, and I could feel his energy, but I didn't say anything esoteric or mention anything New Age or anything to him. And we just had a little conversation, and at the end, he patted me on the back, and he said, "Keep doing what you're doing, Mike. You're doing good." And at that moment, I don't know why, but I just thought, that guy has gone farther down the road than I have in this thing.
Well, yeah, but I mean, the very fact that you're on this path, Mike, you are walking the path of exalted masters. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if they come into your perimeter. You're walking this path. This path is walking you. It will call what sages and wise teachers that need to come into your equation when it's time to have this occur. The very fact that you have that injury right now is curtailing your activities in a certain way that forces you into stillness, right?
All I can do is sit quietly and breathe and chant and pray.
And look at what, I mean, obviously you have the Kundalini. I mean, you know, look at what the Kundalini has brought to you with regards to an enforced attention-getting practice. Instead of the martial arts, instead of the hard partying or whatever, instead of those things, it's given you stillness. Stillness by virtue of as a gift, by virtue of pain. How did that broken collarbone happen?
I was in an Aikido class, and it was a freak accident in an Aikido class.
Right, right. So I think basically what she's giving you is stillness, not only for the mending to take place, which is an obvious thing, but also as a level of spiritual kung fu, if you might want to phrase it that way, a form of spiritual kung fu that allows you to learn how to achieve power through stillness, how to achieve balance, which is the goal of Aikido, how to achieve balance through stillness, through the action of being between the notes, between the words, between the lines.
Yeah, that's where the beauty of music is the space between the notes.
Yeah. And I think that you're being given this great gift right now. And I think that it will not extinguish itself if you don't, like, say, you know, do the Tibetans or anything of that nature. I think that as you do the mantra work, as you do the prayer work, as you do the energetic work, that shifting will occur. And not only will it support the mending of the injury that you currently have, but it's going to push your spiritual understandings forward as well. Silence and serenity are huge combustors for Kundalini.
You know, I feel less compelled to these days. I feel less compelled to preach politics and geopolitics on the internet. I just kind of sloughed off like dead skin just a couple of days ago.
Yeah,
it's interesting.
Yeah. It takes you. I mean, it in a way this world serves multiple different purposes for different people's karmas, but for people with the Kundalini equation karma, this planet is to be used as a way to emulate the two that are one and the one that is two, emulate the equation as above, so below, as within, so without. It's a real star chamber when it comes to the amalgamation of the mundane and the divine.
Yeah.
And that's
yeah.
what's happening here. That's what's happening to you, Mike. That's what's happening to you. And because it
let
doesn't...
It,
yeah,
let it.
Exactly. Let it happen. Step out of the way. Step out of the way with a person's attitudes, with their you know, some of the emotional attitudes that we have. If a person hits us, well, we want to hit them back, that type of thing. Look at changing how you might respond to given situations.
Yeah.
I think the Kundalini speaking through the art form of Aikido has given you that great gift of stillness and serenity. And I think that that for a long time you may want to keep aspects of this practice alive and well in your honoring of the Kundalini within you.
Yeah, I've definitely gotten into the habit of quiet sitting. And it's like playing the guitar or anything else. It's a practice. And the more you do it, the better you get at it. And the more you enjoy it.
And see, because I know that you're in the Reno area, right?
Well, I'm in Las Vegas.
Las Vegas, okay. If you can take those long walks at 3 a.m. in the desert, that's when the prana is the highest, the thickest, is at that time in the desert. And do some deep breathing through your nostrils. The free hand that you have, just let it hang and let it collect energy that's literally sitting on the surface of the desert. If you can do that, and be safe with it. Don't put yourself in danger. And just kind of walk in the desert at that time. Or even in a forested area. If you have forests around Las Vegas, then even there.
I think I could make it to a park at 3 a.m. in the morning. I don't have a car, and I'm not riding my bicycle these days. But,
well, that'd be fine.
I hear you.
That would be fine, Mike. That would be fine, more than fine. Yeah, make it to a park and just start pulling that prana right off the surface of the world. It's called prana feeding, but it will help you with your energy, but also with your injury. It'll help bring that to a greater fruition. And plus, you're in the Shakti pot. So my assumption is that you are practicing the noble behaviors of the safeties every day. And what I would do, Mike, for you specifically, for your specific equation, is I would do the safeties as much as possible. Not so much the bastrika. You understand what I mean by that?
I couldn't quite hear you. Could you say it again, please?
You know what bastrika is?
No.
No.
Not so much the breath of fire.
Is that the alternate nostril breathing?
No, that's pranayama. The breath of fire is really fast in and out of breathing.
I very rarely do that. I call that, that's just something I kind of stumbled on myself. And I only do that when I really need to get into a deep state quickly, or if I feel like I should get into a deep state quickly. But, I will not do that so much these days.
Yeah, well, it's more about what it does to the nostrils. The nostrils are the endpoints of the Ida and the Pingala, which is why pranayama is so effective for Kundalini awakening, is because it's exciting those two great rivers of grace within us. To do that through bastrika really is pushing it. And you can get some pretty nasty headaches from that, migraine headaches and some other types of headaches from that as well. Nice to know that you're not doing it a lot, but if you're not doing it a lot and you just only do it once in a while, well, I don't see a problem with that. But if you're doing it a lot, I would certainly back off of that.
The only side effect that's bothering me these days is hemorrhoids from all the sitting around, laying around.
Well, if you stretch, if you just stand up next to the wall and just bend at the waist, and you'll strengthen those peripheral muscles, and those peripheral muscles will pull the hemorrhoids back into place. You just have to make the effort of what to do.
Yeah, I think the 3 a.m. walks will help too.
It could. Also, use that grandpa's pine tar soap. That will help with the irritation.
Yeah, I have that. I have that in the house.
Yeah, that's good stuff. Yeah, now let me ask you, do you have any questions about your equation that you'd like to discuss?
No, that's what you've said is helpful, and I'm in no rush, and I don't feel any Well, maybe that is part of my equation. Is I don't really feel any urgency about this, although sometimes I do get a nagging sense of I'm wasting my time. I'm not going hard enough. I'm not doing enough. We got to go, go, go. But
well, I don't know that
really
you're in a position. You're not in a position right now to really go, go, go with the injury. You know, the collarbone's pretty important. Part of the body. But what you can do right now is while you have the stillness and you have the time is you can begin to chart how you choose to go within your spiritual development and see how your Kundalini feels about it. You can begin this conversation within you that allows you and your Kundalini to begin to really look at the issues that are the most important to your Kundalini equation. So you can extend yourself out into like, okay, once this is better, then I'll be doing, you know, a spiritual journey in the desert and, you know, I'll do this type of a ceremony in order to demonstrate my willingness and my sincerity to the Kundalini and to what the Kundalini wants to bring to me or to ask me to do. You can begin to really look at that and start that conversation. I really, because you had the spinal sweep and because you've had some of the other phenomena that I feel, you know, is a very good indication that the Shakti is with you. Begin to have that conscious conversation, Mike.
I will.
Yeah. I think you'll find it quite beneficial. Be advised to watch the ethical and morality censors.
I've always considered Las Vegas to be kind of my charnel grounds, and it's a good place to practice if you can maintain your ethical compass.
Well, there you go. Money always tends to make that an interesting experience, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you for calling in, my friend. Thank you for calling in. I'm going to continue on. I don't know how much time. It looks like I have 27 minutes left.
Great.
Thank you for calling in, Mike.
Can't seem to get the computer to play. That's why I called in. Thank you, Kristen. Thank you very much.
You're welcome very much.
We'll put you back on listening, Mike, so you can stay there, okay, and listen.
Thank you, Suntara.
You're welcome. Chrism, could I say something about a message that Elizabeth posted in the chat room? And she put it up while we were discussing the seminar in Minnesota. And she says, I checked today and the prices in flights have started to go down. So
nice.
If people are interested in flying in, maybe track that, see how much it would cost now, and then go on again in 2 days' time and see have they leveled off or are they climbing or that. And maybe again speak with Rosemary because she might have a good idea of how much flights are costing and track the fact that they go down. There's a very good time, I think it's about 3 months or so, this is June, July, yes. This is about 3 months now before the seminar, and that's probably the best time to actually book your flights. I've heard that said before. So thanks a million, Elizabeth. That's very helpful.
Yes, thank you, Elizabeth. Thank you very much for that. Cool. Very nice. Very nice. Well, okay. I've said basically what I think I wanted to say. You can reach the other Kundalini Awakening information at www.kundaliniawakeningsystems1.com. You can reach it on the YouTube network at Chrism and then the number 0 Kundalini. And then you can reach it on Facebook at Kundalini Awakening exclamation point. You can reach it at Kundalini Awakening Systems 2. You can reach it at Kundalini Awake or Kundalini Healing on the Facebook network. and also on Yahoo at Kundalini Awakening Systems 1 at Yahoo, and Kundalini Healing at Yahoo Groups as well. And so I invite any and all of you to come by and have a look at any of those information sources. And remember, as the Radiant Sutras said, you know, cast aside the 10,000 things. Narrow it down, folks. It's not every alien, it's not every tarot card, it's not every roll of the dice that has to make the decision about your future. You make that decision from a conscious, cogent state of being. Cast aside the 10,000 things and love only one. And in this case, I'm going to suggest that you love the Kundalini as the only thing there is. Don't pretend to go on to another, because there isn't. Engage your lively awareness with this one focus, Kundalini. This one object, one thought, one symbol, Kundalini. Then go inside, find the center, right in the middle of the feeling. Attend the blossoming, attention vast as the sky. Amelia Suntara, thank you for co-hosting. It's wonderful to see you back after your 7 days. Thank you.
Thank you, Chrism. It's good to be here. And thank you for this show. I really, really enjoyed it. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you for your big part in it. And thank Rosemary and Eileen and Sarah and Mike Strong. Thank you for everyone on the chat group, Steve Jarecki, all the different guests, Fash G, Elizabeth Dalton Gonzalez, good to see you. Celestial Rubies, good to see you. Thank you all for joining us at this conversation about your Kundalini Awakening experience. And we will see you next week, same time, same station. Go with grace, everyone.